Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the CEC EDISET live lecture. As we have been studying and discussing a lot on biotechnology, and this very week we have dedicated to this very subject, and under this very subject we try to learn about new innovations, new objectives, new perspectives related to this topic. And today also we are going to study a very fresh topic. You might have heard a lot about it, and that is cloning. Now, what is cloning? What are the different perspectives related to it? What are the different aspects you need to learn about? For this, we have again with us in our studios Dr. Hardeep Kaur. She is Assistant Professor in Ramjas College in the Department of Zoology. So first of all, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Hardeep Kaur. Ma'am, you are welcome once again in this EDISET lecture of ours. As our previous lecture went so well, we have discussed and learned a lot about biotechnology. And I would like you to tell our students more about cloning.
Thank you, Gitika. It's indeed a pleasure to be here once again. And cloning is one aspect which is very close to my heart, because it is very interesting aspect. Now, dear friends, once again, I'm here to discuss cloning with you. Cloning, well, just think about it. If we have a clone, and a clone is giving a lecture over it, and I'm enjoying outside, well, how would it be interesting? So the clone doing all your assignments and you enjoying a cricket match, wonderful proposition, isn't it? So the objective of today's lecture is to understand what is cloning, what are the types of cloning, how is it accomplished, how was Dolly made, the very well-known clone, examples of some successful cloning, issues related to cloning, that is ethical, technical, health issues, the benefits of cloning, human cloning, and the latest information. So by the end of the lecture, I'm sure all of you would be very good at it, and you will be able to understand all aspects of cloning very well. Now, if you want to understand cloning, do you know we actually have naturally made clones among ourselves? Yes, I'm talking about identical twins. They are made by nature, they are not made by lab. So what is cloning, if you want to understand that? It is a process of creating an identical copy of an origin. A single cell, it could be a bacteria or a multicellular organism, let's say hypothetically human, that genetically identical to another living organism. This term clone is derived from the Greek word clone, meaning twig, which refers to the process whereby a new plant can be created from a twig. Now, the question now arises is, how is cloning accomplished? Now, let us refresh our memory a bit. We all are zoology students, we are biology students. We know about prokaryotic cell and a eukaryotic cell, two types of cell. A cell is a fundamental unit of living organism. When we are talking about a prokaryotic cell, we all know that a prokaryotic cell does not have a nuclear membrane. The nuclear material is present in the form of a nucleoid, which is a circular DNA molecule. It generally lacks most of the extra nuclear organelles like mitochondria, etc. In a eukaryotic cell, however, we have a defined nuclear membrane. We have extra chromosomal material or organelles like mitochondria, Golgi complex, many others, which a prokaryotic cell is devoid of. The nucleus itself contains the genetic material in the form of chromosomes. The chromosomes are actually made up of genes, genes made up of DNA. So if we actually want to understand a eukaryotic cell, so there's a molecule, that is the DNA, which is the molecular level of a cell. The cell as a whole and cell together forming tissues, organs to form an organism. So three categories are found. So henceforth, we can define cloning in biology or biotechnology as a molecular cloning when we are talking about the gene cloning or the genetic cloning, cellular cloning, where we develop the clones of the cells, and cloning an organism. So we divide this cloning aspect into three categories. Now let us understand what is a molecular cloning. Now when we say we want to clone a molecule, we actually are telling that we want to clone a particular gene or a DNA. A DNA may not be a complete gene. We can clone a promoter region also. We can clone some non-coding regions also, depending on what we need. You must have learned in the techniques like genetic fingerprinting, where a lot of cloning work is done actually, where a lot of DNA, amplified DNA or the clone DNA is utilized for these techniques. Now, in a molecular cloning, we have to find the target DNA. Target DNA actually, as you can see in my slide, target DNA is the DNA which is of my interest. I want to make multiple copies of this target DNA. Now, we need some plasmid vector. Plasmid is an extra nuclear DNA or genetic material present in a bacteria. This plasmid has are self-replicating. Now, what we do? We digest both the plasmid. You can check in the slide. We can digest both the plasmid as well as the target DNA with certain enzymes called restriction endonucleases, which you must have learnt in our previous lecture in this week. These restriction endonucleases are extremely specific. They will cut at a specific point. Now, if we use the same restriction enzymes to digest both the plasmid as well as the target DNA, we will develop similar sticky ends, right? So we have digested the plasmid with one particular restriction enzyme as well as the target DNA with another, with the same enzyme. So we are creating similar sticky ends. Then what we do, we linearize this plasmid having sticky ends and the insert DNA with the same sticky ends. Then what we are going for an annealing of these two. Generally, after annealing, what we get is an unstable annealed construct, which is further ligated using a DNA ligase enzyme, which makes it a stable construct. This recombinant plasmid, we call it a recombinant plasmid because this plasmid actually have a target gene, which was not originally present in the original plasmid. So we call it as a recombinant plasmid. You must understand that in molecular cloning, the guarantee that we will definitely get a target gene within a plasmid is not too high. So we need to have many parameters to ensure that we must or we should get some cloned, some recombinant plasmid with our target gene of interest. There are certain things like, for example, use of certain markers within this plasmid which ensures that target DNA, the recombinant plasmid having the target gene, the colonies carrying them can have a distinction from those which are not carrying them so that we can easily pick them up. It could be a color distinction, the blue and white. I'm not going into that technique, but whereby we can check that there's a blue colony, there's a white colony, one having the transform or the recombinant plasmid, the other not having it. So we can just pick the white colonies having the recombinant plasmid, grow them further. But again, there is no surety. We again need to counter check whether these colonies actually have the recombinant plasmid. Then what we can do, we can actually go for the sequencing. We can go for many other techniques just to find out whether our gene of interest is there. So technically, we have taken a target DNA as, let's say, one, and we are making many copies of it because this recombinant plasmid, once put back into the bacteria, can grow many copies of the target DNA. The same technique I had discussed in my first lecture, in which we had discussed how recombinant insulin, humanized recombinant insulin, was formed. The insulin was taken from the human pancreatic cell and then put in a plasmid and then put back into Escherichia coli. We all know that E. coli has a generation time of 20 minutes. That is, one bacteria divides into two in 20 minutes. So, a copy which was there, one copy was there, now becomes two. So, if we have multiple of that in one day, we have humongous amount of target DNA on our disposal. Extremely nice condition, very nice technique, because by this we can actually do a lot of cost cutting. We discussed this in my first lecture when I was talking about the scope of biotechnology. So, molecular cloning, we had actually created a clone of a target gene. So, when I say I have cloned a gene, I actually mean that I know the gene, its functionality, what it is expressing, what protein it is producing, and where exactly it is located in the genome. That is very, very important. Now, after molecular cloning comes cellular cloning. Now, as I told you, the next level is, after molecule comes the cellular cloning. what we do in generally in this situation, we have a somatic body cell. When I say somatic body cell, that means it has a double or the diploid number of chromosome, 2n number of chromosomes. We take an egg cell, we remove the nucleus from the egg cell, and then we put the nucleus of the somatic body cell into this denucleated egg cell, or the and then this so-called diploid cell is put into a surrogate mother, or and then many different clones of the same cell would be formed. Now, all the cells which are formed will be resembling the somatic body cell from which the nucleus has come. Definitely, there is some difference, because here the mitochondrial DNA is coming from the egg cell which is belonging to someone else, not from the somatic body cell. Despite of that, the new clones which are formed is always similar to the somatic body cell. The purpose of cellular cloning can be two. It can be done for a reproductive cloning, where this clone of cells or the tissue which is formed is now put into a surrogate mother to get an organism, which is the next level of cloning which we'll discuss later. Or this clone of cells can be used for therapeutic, whereby these cells which are now generated can be put back into the organism who require those cells. As I discussed before, that under a, if a person has suffered a heart attack, a part of the heart muscle gets weakened. So if you can generate a stem cell and then use these stem cells to form some heart muscle cell, and these heart muscle cells can further be used to give back the degenerated heart muscle, it is of a prime importance. So the cellular cloning can be for a reproductive cloning, or it can be used for a therapeutic purpose also. But of course, we are all interested in cloning an organism. When we talk about cloning, the first picture that comes to our mind is cloning an organism, human cloning, all these things comes to our mind. So let us discuss more on that aspect. When we talk about cloning an organism, an organismal cloning can be achieved by two methods. One is called the artificial embryo twinning, the other called somatic cell nuclear transfer. Now, let us discuss first the artificial embryo twinning. Now, if you see in my slide, in artificial embryo twinning, this process of a sperm cell fertilizing an egg cell to form a zygote, which is having a 2n number chromosome, and then this zygote divided at a 2-celled state. This is a very natural process. Now, in artificial embryo twinning, what we are doing at a 2-celled stage of this dividing zygote, we actually divide these two cells or separate out these two cells, put them into two surrogate mothers, and then get two embryos and finally two organisms who will be exactly similar because they are coming from the same cell or from the same zygote. This is called artificial embryo twinning. We are actually making a clone of the embryo artificially. Of course, this occurs in nature also, but here we are in doing all this in the laboratory condition. This process is called artificial embryo twinning. Now, there is another method of getting organismal cloning, whereby, which is called somatic cell nuclear transfer. I just discussed it a little while before, wherein we were taking the nucleus from a somatic body cell, putting it into an egg cell with whose nucleus has been removed, getting a zygote, having this nucleus coming from the somatic body cell. This body cell is coming from the organism whom we want to clone. Now, we use this further, put it into surrogate mother, and after putting this into a surrogate mother, we can think about getting an organism who would be exactly resembling the organism from whom the somatic body cell has actually come. Now, this is how Dolly, the first mammalian clone, was made. If you see, we got a huge hue and cry in something around 1997. This Dolly was made by Wilmot, Ian Wilmot, and his co-workers in Rosalind Institute. And this came in the Time magazine as a cover page, wherein the nucleus came from the fin dorset variety, or the fin dorset species of the sheep. It came from the udder cells, the memory cells. The nucleus came from there. It was put into the enucleated oocyte of a Scottish black-faced sheep. the resulting zygote having 2N nucleus coming from the wind torset variety was put into a surrogate mother, and Dolly was formed. Dolly is definitely a replica of the wind torset variety. Now, after Dolly, why Dolly was very important? Dolly was very important because it was the first attempt at the mammalian cell cloning, or at the first attempt at the mammal cloning, organismal cloning. Before that, lots had been written about cloning, lots had been achieved. In fact, people started cloning way back in 1951. If we see some of the species that have been cloned, you will see from this list, the tadpole was cloned in around 1951-52 by Robert Briggs and Thomas J. King, and carp, a fish, was cloned in 1963 in China. The sheep, as I just told, the attempts were made in 1986, while the final attempt of Dolly actually came in the year 1996, but they did not release, they did not tell about this, the news of Dolly's birth till 1997. Dolly died in 2003, living almost for a little more than 6.5 years. Rhesus monkey tetra was made in the year 2000, cattle alpha beta 2001. The cat, copycat CC or little Nicky in 2004 was the first cat cloned under the pet cloning project. I'll come to this project a little while later. The mule, the horse Pomitia. Now, there were reports about human embryo or human cloning in 2004 in Korea. These reports were later retracted, and in Britain. But South Korean scientists, they said they created several cloned human embryos, which they only allowed to develop for a short while, just long enough to extract embryonic stem cells, which could be used in the treatment of diseases. Following that, Snuppy, the dog, was formed in 2005 at Seoul in South Korea. Wolf, Snow Wolf and Snow Wolfie, the two cloned female wolves, water buffalo Samrupa. This is significant because this came from India. Samrupa was the first cloned water buffalo. It was born on February 6, 2009 at India's Karnal National Dairy Research Institute, but died 5 days later due to lung infection. The camel in jars is the first cloned camel in 2009. Again, in 2012, Nuri is the first Pashmina goat that has been cloned, and scientists at the Faculty of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry of Sher-e-Kashmir University of Agriculture Science and Technology of Kashmir successfully cloned the first Pashmina goat and named it Nuri using the advanced reproductive techniques under the leadership of Riaz Ahmed Shah. So, this is all about the various types of cloning. Now, there have been tremendous views. Some people really promote, they say, oh, cloning is very good, it is the new thing. Some people are very against. If we hear the, we see the comment of President Clinton, and he says that any discovery that touches upon human creation is not simply a matter of scientific inquiry. It is actually a matter of morality and spirituality as well. Each human life is unique, born of a miracle that reaches beyond laboratory sciences. This is his view. A top politician whose view is like this. So definitely there are many issues related to cloning. So if we actually talk about drawbacks of cloning, or as we say, playing God, there are many ethical issues. Romans and Catholic feel that it is against the God's will. How can you clone this? How the recreation or formation of a new individual is actually the work of God. How can you do that in laboratory condition? Then there is another school of thought which is very similar to this, who says that the soul enters when sperm and the egg nucleus actually join to form a zygote. So naturally, when this formation of a clone is devoid of fertilization, that means there is no soul entering. So a organism which has formed with no soul is actually a devil. Then they also think that if cloning becomes successful, there are many chances that there would be many miscarriages. There would be many genetic defects. Naturally, when there are genetic defects or miscarriages, they say this cloning is actually almost pertaining to a murder of an individual. Then a very important aspect which is also belongs to the health is that there is no genetic variability. if we have clones, who doesn't want to have a clone? I would also like to have a clone of myself I would like to sit back and let the clone do all my dirty work. So, if we have clones everywhere around us, there is no genetic variability. No genetic variability means no natural selection. Because for natural selection to take place, we need variation. People, population devoid of variation is heading for an extinction. We must understand that. So many ethical issues were there. Of course, there were technical hurdles. It is a very expensive technique. To get one dolly, 277 fused eggs were utilized. 29 embryos were transferred in 13 sheep to get one pregnant sheep. So, you can understand the cost of making one dolly. And understandably so, the cost to clone one human could be much more than $100,000. Which is in Indian rupees, if we think, almost amounting to 60 lakh rupees. Now, if it is such an expensive process, then how come it will be easy for a person who is actually needing it? So, those aspects, the pros and cons, I'll be dealing with it later in my lecture. Of course, there are health issues also. Now, if we have an entire population of similar individuals, if one individual gets exposed to a pathogen and dies, chances are that pathogen will lead to the death of the entire or just finishing up of the entire population of individuals because they don't have any variation. If a pathogen is effective against one individual, it will be effective against all the clones of that individual. The entire population might get wiped out. Then again, if the clones are there in a population, there will be inbreeding. Inbreeding will lead to more of clones. Again, the same aspect, there would be no variation. The entire population will be similar. No variation, no natural selection, no evolution. So, we are again heading to extinction of the entire population. So, these were the drawbacks of cloning, but then there are many benefits of cloning. This, if you will see, is Dolly with her first born lamb, Bonnie. Now, Dolly was, as I just told you, born in 1996 and the news came in 1997 from the Rosalind Institute from the Ian Wilmette Laboratory. Now, when Dolly died in 2003, many people said she died because the somatic cell from which the nuclear material actually came had already lived, the fin dorset variety had already lived the 6 years of its life. So, the nuclear material, you must understand, during the process of aging, we have telomere shortening. Telomere shortening is a process. Telomeres are a protein DNA cap kind of a structure which are present on the chromosomes, and with aging, this leads to telomere shortening. They said the nucleus which has been taken from the somatic cell had already aged. Now, when the new organism that has formed will be suffering from a lot of diseases of the old age, aging. They said probably the Dolly died of arthritis. And many other things were said about Dolly. But there was a statement coming from the people who actually promote cloning and also from the Ian Wilmette lab, from the Rosalind Institute, that Dolly actually died because of respiratory problem due to lung infection and not because of all those things or aging related problems which people are promoting or propagating that she died of. Nevertheless, this is again, I am showing you Dolly with the Bonnie. And after Dolly came Polly and Molly. Polly and Molly were the transgenic varieties of sheep who had the gene of human clotting factor 9. Now, you must understand, a person deficient of clotting factor 9 gene will not have a regular clotting of blood. Now, because of that, lots many problems come. There is no clotting of blood. The person can actually die because of a small injury. Now, what they did, they put this gene just next to the gene which is responsible for making milk in the sheep. Now, sheep is going to form milk. When milk is produced, this gene which is just placed next to the gene which is responsible for making milk is present. This gene will all automatically get expressed. Now, the sheep is producing a lot of milk. The milk is having human factor 9 gene, clotting factor 9 gene. We can take out this clotting factor 9 from this milk and easily use this. Initially, we used to take out this factor from the human blood For that we used to require a lot of blood, and only then we used to get a very little amount of clotting factor. By this process we were easily able to harbor or to take out humongous amount of clotting factor 9, and hence used in those people who are deficient in it. So definitely this is one benefit. If we want to know about more benefits, of course, why clone? Because there are some benefits. Let's understand those benefits. Improvement of meat, milk production. Production of disease-resistant animals. We did lots of understanding about the disease-resistant plants in our first topic. Similar thing was done. See, we used to do, since time immemorial, we used to inbreed or do selective breeding of animals to get those hybrids who were much more disease resistant. But by cloning, we can get the same purpose done of production of disease resistant animals at much less cost. And in selective breeding, you must understand, it was, we were just doing hit and trial method. We might get, we might not get. But by cloning, we are very sure that if we get, we will be getting the right thing. Then production of biopharmaceuticals. I gave you an example of insulin. How insulin and the production of proteins also at industrial scale. Example again is insulin. Production of tissues, organs for transplant. If we can get stem cells, we can make cells, we can do cellular cloning, we can actually make those tissues which are required. The heart tissue, heart muscle tissue can be prepared and put it into the heart, and we can replenish those muscles which have gone weakened because of a heart attack. The cloning of extinct species is a very important aspect of cloning and a very important thing. This I will deal it in detail later in my lecture. Cloning can also be used to test for genetic diseases. It can regenerate nerves or spinal cord tissues, same technique how I described about the heart muscle tissue. It can help in plastic surgery. It can grow skin grafts for burn victims. The skin cells can be made artificial in the lab, and those grafts can be used for the burn victims. It can manufacture bone, fat, cartilage. Many benefits are there. Further benefits, the possibility of cloning a valued pet provides its owner with a degree of hope. Now, you must understand, this is a pet cloning project whereby people who want to get their pet back, they can take some cells of the pet and then go to a company and ask that company that we want to clone our pet. These are the cells of my pet. This is the blood cell of my pet. Please clone my pet. And those companies are actually helping them to get their pets back. For example, a person's pet has died and now he wants his pet. He's too attached to the pet. But then again, it's only for those people who are having money, because this is honestly a luxury who few can afford. Otherwise, people who actually are in a dire need of cloning may not get it because the cost is high in this case. So this has pros as well as cons. Now, anyways, cloning the pet project, the pet cloning project is actually there in America, where many companies have opened up and they're extensively cloning the pets. But definitely this also have a benefit. It can provide blind persons with more of the very best sight dogs. You know, the dogs can be a boon for them, these blind persons. So this is a big benefit to them. UK, United Kingdom dairy producers are cloning elite dairy cows and bulls to increase the supply of superior genetics. The horse breeders want to propagate their horses' athletic and genetic qualities. So these are some of the benefits of cloning. Now again, coming to the most interesting topic of human cloning. We all want to know about human cloning, what is going around the world. So two aspects are there of human cloning. The naturally occurring human cloning and the artificial human cloning. When you say naturally occurring human cloning, as I just told you, that we should be aware that we have naturally occurring clones of humans around us. This is nothing but the identical twins that are born, you know, they are naturally occurring. We don't know anything in the laboratory. It is nature who is making sure that we get clones. They are absolute clones of each other. Then artificial human cloning, where we are actually cloning individuals. Now, I must say that not much has, because of the ethical issues, not much has been done in case of artificial human cloning, although there had been many reports coming here from here and there. But in most of the countries like Canada, US and all, the human cloning has been banned because of many ethical issues. Now, I'm just about to give you some of the examples of cloning. For example, as you can see in the slide, this is the cow which has been cloned in August 1997. The purpose was to improve meat and the dairy quality. Then this is Genie, the first genetically engineered animal. This is a transgenic animal to produce a human protein drug, that is human protein C in her milk. This was produced in the year, this was produced in the year 1997. And Genie was very important because in Genie, what has happened, they had put the gene of human protein C just next to the milk producing gene. Now, when Genie had a litter, you can see Genie with the litter, the milk was produced in copious amounts. Now, along with the milk, milk was providing nutrition to the newborns, but it was also providing human protein C to humans. Now, this protein C, the human protein C deficiency, is a genetic trait that predisposes one to the formation of various clots in the blood. Now, through the milk of Genie, a sufficient amount of human protein C was formed. 1 gram of human protein C could be taken easily out from 1 liter of milk, which is almost 200 times more than what we could take out from the human blood. If we take 1 liter of human blood, much lesser amount of human protein C can be taken out. And the best part is that about 1/3 of this recombinant protein is actually biologically active. So, a big boon to this industry is Genie. Now, I was talking to you about this pet cloning project. This is one of the, if you go to their website also, you can see, you can actually order to clone your pet, you know. This is a company called Perpetuate Incorporation, a privately held company which was founded in 1998 by Dr. Heather Bisoff and Ron Gillespie. It's a pet cloning project, and these are just two of the examples. They have numerous examples where Bobo is a clone which has come from the original pet in California, Absolute is in France, and you will see lovely pictures on their site actually. Now, the first report of the cloning in cat came in February 2002. Again, this is in commercial pet cloning project. The report came in Nature. You will see CC is the cloned kitten who is a clone of Rainbow. Rainbow is the donor cat. And this is CC's kitten, 3 kittens produced. Actually, this is important. This is in 2006 that CC produced 3 kittens. This is important because initially with the death of Dolly, a lot of hype was created that cloning is causing production of individuals who are actually aged and would not lead to high rate of survival, and probably they won't have much of a reproduction, although Dolly gave to Bonnie also. But this is very important because CC was very healthy, it produced 3 kittens and it lived its life. Cloning of horse in August 2003 was Promethea is the first cloned horse. Here, Promethea is standing with a genetically identical surrogate mother. This is again a commercial pet cloning project which was reported in Nature in the year 2003. Now, in 2005, the cloning of dog Snappy. Here, if you see, Snappy is sitting in the middle along with the father, that is Afghan hound, the male Afghan hound from whom the somatic cell came. And the surrogate mother is a yellow Labrador on the right. This is again a commercial pet cloning project which came, the report came in Nature in 2005. If you see here, Snappy at 1 year old, very agile, very active. Now, human clone. Britain grants embryo cloning patent and became the first country in the world to grant a patent covering cloned early stage human embryos. The decision ignited new controversy among biotechnology critics, even though Geron Corporation, this company who actually was really investing in human cloning, said that it has no intention of creating cloned humans. It was just doing to produce cells. Now, a lot of UN cries, well, as I just told you, human cloning as of now, it's not done. Or it is, if it is done, it is done, the results are not published because actually it is banned around the world. Now, the most important aspect of cloning is cloning of endangered animal species. Now, this is a very important aspect. In 2001, a cow named Bessie gave birth to a cloned Asian gaur, an endangered species. But the calf died after just 2 days. In 2003, a Bentang, which is a wild cattle, was cloned, followed by 3 African wildcat. These successes provided hope that similar techniques of using surrogate mother of another species might be utilized, because these extinct species are going or probably gone. Now, if we can actually take out or reserve these cells and put them into a surrogate mother after cloning them, and we actually can get an extinct species back, it will be really nice, because our kids won't be able to see, they will only be able to see the pictures of the extinct species. Now, if we can actually get those extinct species back, it would be really great. Thinking this or anticipating this possibility, tissue samples from the last bucardo, called Pyrenean ibex, it's an Iberian wild goat, were frozen in liquid nitrogen immediately when the last Iberian wild goat died in 2000. Its cells were put in liquid nitrogen, and researchers are trying hard to clone it into a new individual and hence bring back all those extinct species. They are also planning to clone the endangered species like giant panda and cheetah, Asiatic lion, musk deer, etc. So this would be a tremendous impact on the ecology, on the world, because now we might bring back all those extinct species. We know there had been many reports of all this in the fiction way, you know, in the media. If you see all those movies like Jurassic Park, or if you see movies like Island, there are a lot of cloning aspect has been covered, wherein the clones of dinosaurs have been made in Jurassic Park, etc. Those are fictions, but this is possible, and people are doing it, and people are getting results. So if we can bring back these extinct species, kudos to them. So this is just a comic strip where it's written that all animals are equal, but when they are coming out from the cloning room, some become more equal than others. Now, the very important aspect now which we should deal is human cloning ethical? Is it right to clone human? Now, there are many issues. As I just told you, there are many beliefs, religious beliefs. People say, God is the creator of life. Why are you playing God? Some people believe that cloning is like just playing God. They believe God is the creator of all and all living and non-living things. Why do you meddle with his work? People believe human cloning takes away from an individual being unique. You know, we are all unique technically, but if we have clones, we no longer remain unique. It is believed that a human has the right for the full human development in a natural environment, and that the human embryo should be left alone after 14th day of fertilization. This is a very strong belief of Catholics and Romans. Some religious belief people believe that if you clone a human being, as I just told you, they said it will have no soul. The breath of life is given to us by God, not by scientists splicing genes in a lab. This was the view of many people. Richard Nicholson of the British Bulletin of Medical Ethics said that cloning research may well be like sowing the seeds of our own destruction. Very strong religious views people have. Very strong issues people created. So let us understand the pros and cons of human cloning. Let's discuss the pros. The cloned body part can serve as a backup system for human. If we are devoid of something, or let's say accidentally we became devoid of some part, we always will have a backup of that. It will have a solution to infertility. It will combat genetic diseases. See, most of the people who are born with deficiency of a particular gene, the gene can be cloned from another individual and put into these individuals, and they can lead a normal life. They can replicate animals for research purposes. They can enable alterations of plants and animals. Cloning can lead to production of people with desirable traits. We like someone, we will have a clone of that person. Of course, it can have cons also. It weakens the diversity and ability of adaptation. As I told you, if we are all alike, one person can just wipe out our entire population. One pathogen can easily make us die, because we are all similar. If we are susceptible to that pathogen, then God will only save us, probably. Then again God comes. then production of undesirable traits, technical and economic barrier, cost effectiveness. It is not a cost effective process. It naturally, if it is not cost effective, it cannot be reaching the common man. Only elite people can go ahead with cloning. They might go for a pet cloning purpose, they have their own clones, but a person who's actually desiring or is deserving, not desiring but deserving it because of some reason, he may not be able to get the benefit of this technique because he doesn't have money. There are human and animal rights involved, ethical and moral principles involved. It will devalue the mankind, and here the human will be acting as a god. So these are few of the pros and cons of human cloning. Now let's just not think about cloning for a while. This is Transgenics. Now Transgenics is also called a snowflake baby. It's an outcome of, there was a family who went in for to a fertility or infertility expert, Dr. Bill Frist. This family called the Johns family, actually they adopted 10 frozen embryos. These frozen embryos were left over from an earlier fertility treatment of some other family. These embryos were left out, they were present as frozen embryos. They adopted 10 of them. Now 7 got destroyed during the thawing process. Let's call them as Timmy, Tammy, Tom, Terry, Trent, Tara, Tay, Johns. However, 2 of the remaining 3, Toby and Tanya, they failed to take hold of the womb. So only one was left, which developed into Transgenics, a beautiful baby, the snowflake baby. Yet people called Dr. Bill Frist a traitor. Now you will be asking, why am I telling you about this Transgenics? Transgenics has nothing to do with cloning. This is just an in vitro fertilization technique we are talking about. But there is an analogy. I'll just show you a few of its pictures. Here it is President Bush holding Transgenics and the Johns family with their son, JJ and Tracy Johns, posing with their son Transgenics. Now the reason I'm talking about Transgenics is because to get one Transgenics, 10 fertilized frozen embryos were utilized. Lots of money went into getting Transgenics. It is very similar to cloning, where a lot of money is used to get a clone. Now it is very similar because same factors are there, same issues are there, same money matter is there, same resources are there, lots of resources are required. But then if you go back to this picture, isn't it better to have Transgenics, the warm cuddly Transgenics in your hand, rather than to have 10 cold embryos put in some, stacked in some freezer somewhere? I mean, of course, this is a debatable issue. The issue was similar, had analogy with cloning, that's why I brought this up. So I feel we all have different views on that, but yes, I feel that it is much better to have a baby rather than to keep the egg somewhere stacked in the freezer. Now this is something which came up. A controversial fertility doctor, Dr. Panaitis Zivos, he claimed to have cloned 14 human embryos and transferred 11 of them into womb of 4 women who had been prepared to give birth to clone babies. None of the women became pregnant, but the doctor indicated, this was the first indication which he gave, that this was just the first chapter for his ongoing attempts to produce a clone baby from parents' skin cells. Now this was another attempt by Dr. Zivos, who this is Caddy, who died at the age 10 in a car crash in the US. Her blood cells were frozen and were given to Dr. Zivos, who fused them with the cow's egg to create cloned human animal hybrid embryos. Of course, he was not successful. Lots of reports have come from Dr. Zivos' laboratory, but around the world, these reports have been found not to be true and fluke, and the media has been asked, has been banned from taking any reports and publishing from which have been coming from Dr. Zivos' laboratory. Now if you want into the insight about any of the topics which I covered today, you can see these few of these topics in the bibliography and can go back and check out and go into the in-depth study of that. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much also for giving a deep insight into this very topic, because we have heard lots about cloning since I'm a child, since I'm learning and since I'm studying. But studying cloning like this through you, it's very tremendous and very, I could say, I have no words to explain this. But yes, I have questions to ask you. As you said about the life of a clone, can we say that yes, life of a clone is not too much?
No, because it has been proved wrong. Initially, when Dolly was made, they said that Dolly died because of arthritis and because of all those old age problems, you know. So, because so it is not, it hasn't lived its life. So, if we get a clone or if we make a clone, it is definitely going to, you have to reduce that life, which that somatic cell from where the nucleus is coming has already lived, you know. But with the new cloning aspect, this has been found with the new cloning examples the people have come up with. This has been found, this is not true. And why cloning is important, this somatic cell nuclear transfer was very important, is because here what we are trying, you know, in the somatic cell nuclear SCNT technique, the most important thing is we were cloning. For example, in Dolly also, we were taking an udder cell. The udder cell is a already differentiated memory cell. But we are de-differentiating it and making it a zygote, which is capable of making the organism, complete organism. This is a big discovery, because initially it was thought that after differentiation, you cannot de-differentiate a cell. But it was very important to see that already differentiated cell can be de-differentiated again to produce a complete individual.
A complete individual. But if we talk about the characteristic of this clone, you want to say that a clone has its individual characteristics, or all the characteristics which is that it has inherited?
It will be having all the characteristics of the, see, technically, as I told you, by the somatic cell technique, we are giving mitochondria from the not from the donor. So, if we actually want to have an absolute clone, we should have the mitochondrial DNA, because mitochondrial DNA and the extracellular material, extranuclear material also have an impact. So, when we are taking this mitochondrial DNA from some other variety, for example, let's say Snuppy. Snuppy came from the Afghan hound. The nucleus was from Afghan hound, but was produced of what the surrogate was the Labrador. Mm-hmm. So, let's say hypothetically, if the cell is coming, the enucleated cell is coming from some other species, it will have the mitochondria of that species. So, definitely the clone which is produced should not be called a 100% clone of the original, but it is almost similar to the one which from where we have got. So, if we want to have a 100% clone, the enucleated cell should also be coming from the same organism whom we are cloning.
That's why we have learned about, heard a lot about, as you said, that producing the clone is very cost. We can say that it's not an easy task. One should be affordable for this to produce a clone. We have heard a lot about the celebrities who love their pets much.
Yes.
And if the pet has some tendency of dying very soon, they seems to have a clone of that pet. Now the question arises, you have told about Dolly and Bonnie, can a clone further produce another clone?
A clone can be utilized, yeah, why not? If a clone is there, it is an individual now, right? Thus, nucleus from this clone can be taken and the entire thing would be repeated, can be repeated. So, now if you have two clones and you can actually inbreed them, you will have a third clone. There
exactly.
You don't need to do the entire SCNT technique again.
In this way, as we talked about the endangered species which are on the verge of extinction, we can save them in this very manner, about how you explained about the tigers who are on the verge of extinction, and we are carrying so much of projects on Save the Tiger. So, with the help of this technique, I hope it would be beneficial for us to save
partly
the extinction.
Tiger is not at the level of extinction right now, but yes, definitely for cheetah and Asiatic lion who are actually getting extinct. This is going to be a big technique, and I feel that the tremendous application of this technique should be put into the cloning of the extinct species, because this is where we should be, we don't have those species now. So if we can bring them back, it will be a boon.
It will be a boon. But ma'am, do you feel or do you think a special care required to be taken with these cloned species or cloned animals or human beings we are talking about?
I guess not, because once they are cloned and once they have become a complete organism, it is an organism coming from the earlier organism. You will need only that much of care which you will generally do it for a normal organism.
But are they susceptible to the same disease? If a person is susceptible to certain kind of diseases, the clone is likely to have those diseases?
Definitely. Because if you're talking about the characteristics. Because it is having the same genetic makeup. It is having a genetic makeup which is exactly similar to its producer. So, if the producer is getting susceptible to a pathogen, definitely. That's the concern for us. Na? If the clone, if we clone, make a clone of one individual and we'll have a same population of all those individuals, mm-hmm. one pathogen will be enough to wipe that particular population.
If we talk about the other benefits of this cloning, do you feel it is very effective from the research point of view?
From the researcher point of view, it is definitely effective. It is also effective from other point of views also. For example, for a dairy production, for we dealt with cloning at three aspects: cloning of gene, cloning of cell, cloning of organism. If we clone a gene, for example, in insulin production, we are getting humongous amount of insulin right now. It is actually cloning an insulin gene. Mm-hmm. You know, if we understand that, we have cloned a gene in a system where we can get a lots of gene now, many copies of that gene, which was not possible otherwise. Otherwise, we used to, as I told you in my last lecture, if we needed insulin, we used to go back to bovine or cattle and we used to take out from them, from their pancreas, and then use it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it will have a harmful effect because it is not a humanized insulin which we are using. But by recombinant DNA technology, we are not only getting the humanized insulin, we are also getting it in heaps of amounts, in high amounts.
Exactly. And as you said about the this cloning is also helpful in treatment of numerous diseases.
Yes.
More clones are produced, at least we'll have a backup with us to treat
yes.
multiple of diseases.
Yes, definitely.
Now, ma'am, the question is, as you said about the natural clones as well as artificial occurring cloning, what is the major difference, or what is the major difference you feel is between the two clones?
See, difference whether, for example, I gave you an example of artificial embryo twinning. It is a process which is actually occurring in nature, wherein a zygote at a two-cell stage, the two cells are actually separated out, put into two surrogate mothers. This is in nature also, identical twin is clone of each other, you know. There, I don't know what reasons might be, a two-cell stage, the two cells get separated and each of the cell becomes a individual. That's why they are completely identical to each other. The same thing we are replicating in the lab. By actually in the laboratory condition, we are actually at a two cell stage, separating the two cells, making them grow into two different individuals. So technically there is not much of a difference, except that here we are doing it artificially or replicating what nature is doing.
But if we talk about this artificial clone, how much time does it take to produce a clone?
It all depends. See, we started off in 1951, but to get a first mammalian clone, it came out in 1997. So you can understand a lot of time. But then now it is commercially being done. You can understand. You are giving an order online to clone it, providing the company a cell. Probably, see, I haven't got my pet clone, but probably in few, they must be having a very less time. See, to develop a technology initially, it takes a lot of time. But once the technology is developed, then things become very fast.
But as per as you said, there are very ethical perspective regarding this. It's not ethically correct. If you talk about country like India, at what extent it is permissible here in India about the human clones?
Human clones, as I told you, is not permissible anywhere right now. Mm-hmm. We do not have human cloning anywhere officially. Unofficially, we cannot speculate on that. But officially, most of the countries have very strict rules. In India, as I told you, I gave you two examples of the Pashmina goat and all. We did it in animals. We are still doing it in animals. But human cloning, if it is done, it is a very hush-hush thing. But I am not aware of that.
But for the animal clones, we have a permission that we can go for the animal cloning.
Yes.
Now, if we talk about the nature and the scope of the study of this cloning, what do you feel, what future it has?
Well, it has a tremendous application. We know, we cannot defy that it has a tremendous application. See, if we can have extinct species coming back, if we can clone those cells which are required to replenish our lost cells, if we can clone genes of interest to produce lots of, let's say, antibiotics, lots of vaccines and proteins of our interest, I think it has a lot of application. And we have, I would rather go with the cloning because, every new discovery has both bad as well as good things. the good things are like this. We should utilize it nicely. We should have use this technology in a good way. Of course, there would always be cons for it also. There would always be some drawbacks in it also. It has a tremendous application, I would say.
Is there any example of any clone, if we talk about in terms of animals only, which has lived for years and years?
No, these clones are actually living their complete life. But when I am talking about animals, animals don't have a long life, so called. I mean, if we are dealing, we are talking about human per se animals. These animals who have cloned, they generally are living their full lives, you know. So actually, we should be saying that cloning doesn't affect the longevity of animals.
We can definitely not say, because some things which are in our hand and something which is in are not in our hands. But all for the students who might be watching this lecture might be curious to know where they can study about cloning, or if they wanted to make a career in this, is it possible?
See, it is definitely possible. As I gave you two of the institutes name in India itself, where cloning is actively done. There are institutes in Bikaner also, where they are working a lot on the camel also. There are so many institutes who are working on this. You just need to go back to the Google out and check it out. Where, of course, abroad the cloning is much, the frequency of clones, as you see, I just told you about a commercial aspect where they are doing a pet cloning process. And this company is now open up where you just need to give this. So cloning actually is done much at a much higher scale abroad as compared to India. But they can do it. Any biotechnology institute who is actually working on it, they need to go out there and check it out who all are working out there.
You raised the term doping. What does doping actually means?
Doping?
If I'm not wrong, you were concerned only with the cloning.
I think you missed out doping.
I missed out with that. Now, what else because time also very less left with us. Uh-huh. Anything which you think might be highlighted?
Well, I would say the we need to be very careful about cloning. Now, as it is one important field of research in biotechnology, every research definitely deals with some cost. But yes, there are ethical issues when we are talking about a human cloning. A human clone will have a tendency, there would be miscarriages involved, there would be chances of genetic error, because here we are actually meddling with the genetic material. So chances are that we might have some errors in cloning. So those things needs to be taken care of. You need to be very precise. The clones have to be very precise. There is no point of getting any error there, you know. But this is with respect to human. The same goes for other animals also. Why should we have animals who should be born with some genetic defect? So the cloning as such should be done very nicely. Ethically also, we should resort to cloning where it is essential. I feel that pet cloning may increase the cost overall, and hence the benefit of cloning might not go to the people who actually deserve it. That important aspect must be very well taken care of during this cloning.
Exactly. And what about your say on this ethical perspective, that about the human cloning, that unnecessarily I don't think there is a requirement. Do you feel so?
See, well, I am not capable of answering that, because a person who has lost a person only knows the pain of losing a person, you know. So there I cannot actually say that it is not required. Research of any kind is required. I would not say any kind of research is bad. Again, we need to be careful how we are doing it. We need to be very balanced in our approach, and we should not be just doing it for the heck of doing it, because specifically the human cloning I am talking about. For animal cloning also, they have animal rights also. We should be very aware of their rights, that we cannot be just making them a guinea pig.
We can say that life is very important, and for survival of the life, we are for the thinking of cloning. And with this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much for giving such a deep insight into this very topic. I hope all the students who might have watched us might be benefited from this very lecture. Thank you so very much for being with us.